So, when Lab of Legends first launched, neither you nor the AI opponents would lose the game by decking out. Since then, updates have made it so that you and your opponents can both lose the game by trying to draw while having zero cards remaining in your deck. To which, of course, I immediately asked, is it possible for me to beat Lab of Legends by decking out every single opponent? Now, if you guys watch my daily streams on Twitch, you know I love doing challenge mode lab runs, and if not, you might remember the first challenge I did on YouTube, beating labs without attacking. However, today's challenge will be quite a bit harder. To be able to deck out the opponent every time, we'll have to stall long enough to survive up to 40 turns while simultaneously making sure we don't deck out before our opponents do. To do this, we'll have to use in-depth knowledge of each and every enemy deck, as well as some crazy thinking outside the box strategies. Because this challenge is so extreme, we are playing this on normal difficulty, but if I beat it, we'll see. Maybe I'll do it on a harder difficulty later. Don't hold me to that. And also, to make it even harder on myself, Twitch chat and I decided on some self-imposed rules. We aren't allowed to use Nab from any cards, perks, or items, or draft Maokai or Lissandra. We have to mill out the opponent the old-fashioned way every single time. Now, before I even pick a deck for the run, I have a terrifying realization. You guys point out that the second enemy Mistwraiths has the special power to shuffle back their own killed Mistwraiths into their deck. But if we're also forced to block them every turn, then they'll always have more Mistwraiths to draw into. I think about it long and hard, and looking at the starter decks, I decide the only option for even getting past Mistwraiths reliably has to be the Lulu deck.
Here I am! Wherever here is!
This is because of her champ spell, Whimsy. If I have a Lulu on the board, I can play Lulu's Whimsy, which shuffles in another copy into my deck while transforming the Mistwraith to stop their reshuffle. Lulu is pretty widely regarded as one of the weakest starter decks in labs to begin with, and also, unfortunately for me, I decided to do this challenge days before the update that would buff Twin Disciplines, Will of Ionia, and Young Witch, making it that much harder on me. I mean, the literal third of the starter deck is effectively nerfed. That being said, I don't see a single other way it would even be possible to get past Mistwraiths, so I pick the Lulu starter deck, and we're off. For my first try, I'll start with a newly added perk, Hold Them Off. Freezing the strongest enemy unit every single turn should be perfect for this forced stall strategy, especially since my starter deck, Lulu, has no stall. So we begin against the first opponent, Spiders, and already on turn two, we have to start making awkward trades. So yeah, we're basically just gonna have to start blocking down. Greenglade Duo, unfortunately, is kind of useless here. It's literally just a literal spider blocker. And this, my friends, is what makes this challenge run so painfully difficult. We're forced into the Lulu deck because it's the only way to get past Mistwraiths, but her support deck is geared towards aggression with cards like Picks and Elusives, which will be almost completely useless since I can't kill the enemy Nexus. A couple of turns later, and I realize something equally scary. I'm never allowed to let Lulu die. The only way I can shuffle cards back in is with Lulu's Whimsy, and if one of my only two Lulus dies to anything, I will no longer have any way to win the game at all, which means we'll have to bait out removal before we're even able to play our first Lulu. And that's not all either, because after blocking Spiders for 10 turns, I realize I need to level my Lulu to start generating free barriers every turn. It's the only way to have the sustained stall. But here's one last problem I didn't consider. And that's the tricky thing. We have to level our Lulu while not killing their Nexus. But leveling our Lulu causes us to attack. So we have to attack in a way that like basically generates the least. Even if I attack like this already, it's already too much. So yeah, I'm forced to attack to level my Lulu. But if I accidentally kill the opponent Nexus, I'll lose the challenge on the spot because we have to deck them out every time. That being said, Spiders ended up not being too tough, and just keeping my Lulu alive ended up being enough to run them out of resources. I scoop up Kindred to give another stalling engine and go on to Mistwraiths. Mistwraiths is quite a bit harder already, as expected. My lack of fearsome blockers makes it difficult, but luckily the Mask Mother I picked up in the Kindred pack turns my Snapper statline into a 4-7 and is able to block down super well. I take some big Nexus damage, but manage to take control of the board. I realize a really cool thing I can do is attack in a way that will force the AI to block to keep his Nexus alive. Something. I could actually force him to block Kindred by doing this, because the AI will have no choice but to block something with Kindred. Nah, I need to level my Lulu. I can't afford to deal 6 damage to him, because to be able to win this, I need help Pixes, which means I need to attack with supports. And if I deal too much face damage right now just to get him to block, then I can't level my Lulu, and I can't get barrier for free every single round, which is really bad. And just a few turns later, holding back pays off. So the Young Witch buffs Lulu. Lulu buffs Kindred to specifically do nothing. He's forced to block this, but the Lulu levels, which is really, really important. Right? So he'll block one of my quick attacks, just gives me a free kill. Alright, and this is why we didn't use our health. We didn't attack him before, because his health is our resource, right? Like, here we had to set him to 2. And now we've got the help Pixes every turn. With Lulu leveled, our plan of whimsying the Mistwraiths to force a deck out works perfectly. From this point on, we just block the squirrels until the Mistwraiths decks out, and we're through onto Thresh. Now, in this next item draft, we can't take Avarice Blade because, keep in mind, Nab is banned by our rule set, so we just go for the Philosopher's Stone on Lulu and scoop up a Shadow Shift while we're at it. So here's the first big problem, which is that Thresh, our next opponent, is very aggressive, and Mistwraiths have already costed us half of our Nexus health. Not only that, but if Thresh ever levels up, his power will put 3 champions into his own deck, which will make it even harder to deck him out. We block down the early game, trying to save every point of Nexus health we possibly can. We manage to set up a board at 6 HP, but he plays Prankster and threatens a really scary attack. Is this guy a genius? Wait, he's shuffling. He's boxing nothing. He's glimpsing his own Thresh. What? We take some damage to the Prankster, have a plan to kill the next turn, but then this happens. This bot is so smart. How is this bot so smart? What? What the fuck? So that's attempt number 1, and back to the start we go. I'm dreading Thresh for this challenge. I think it's going to be a huge obstacle to be able to make it through. We make it through spiders again on our second run, and Mistwraiths again too. In the process, we scoop up Garen since he's good at setting up a wall, and his champion spell is Judgment, which can completely sweep a board. The only other notable thing that happened in the redo was this. Pretty sure his last card is DN. Wait, what's DN? DN is D's nuts. You got me, dude. Well done. After falling for the most basic trick in the book, we next up have a really tricky pick. I can equip either of my champs with Doran's Blade, Chain Vest, or Archangel Staff. Now, you guys in Twitch chat want me to pick Archangel Staff, which is normally nuts in these runs, but the problem with it here is because we're forced to stall for so long, we're too limited on our cards as resources, so burning through them faster with more mana doesn't really do as much. We're not going to be mana starved in this. I go with Chain Vest Lulu instead. This will keep her alive through a lot of stuff, including her own attacks, and will help stabilize early. The next pack, we reroll into a Deadbloom Wanderer. Deadbloom Wanderer is an auto lock. Super happy for it. Lifesteal is an early play. The easiest choice of my life. It does toss 3. Fuck. That tossing 3. Oh, God. God fucking damn it. Is that actually a problem? I'm gonna go for it, but like, there actually will be some games where like tossing out of my resources will be a huge problem. My logic for Deadbloom Wanderer is, even though this challenge might seem like a race to the bottom of the deck challenge, as long as I have 2 of the same champion and can reshuffle it over and over again, getting to the bottom of my deck isn't a problem for me. The problem is surviving until that point and keeping my champions alive, which Deadbloom should be able to help me with. And with that, our rematch against Thresh starts. We're at 22 health now as opposed to our 16 last time, but that won't last long against him. I get my early Lulu on board to try to level her as fast as possible. I need to force him to block. So I need to start jamming in attacks now. Deck extended 2 cards. Oh god, Yeti Yearling does extend him. So yeah, Thresh got a Yeti Yearling off of his Warden's Prey he played earlier. Alright, he doesn't get vaults. This is really good. This is really good. We're safe from a lot of things.
Are you sure about that?
What the fuck? After getting unbelievably high rolled, I have no choice but to whimsy the Yeti, but apart from that, this doesn't look too bad. I have a second whimsy for one of his undying, and this time an answer to the prankster that's gonna work just fine. Alright, so this attack forces him to block with prankster. God, one of these days he's just not gonna block. One of these days he's just not gonna block and just lethal himself, and I'm gonna have to concede. But until that day, we're good. His Thresh comes out at the same time as my Garen, and while I kill his Thresh, these two remaining undyings are a real problem. He threatens Garen with a Crumble, but I'm ready and counter it with Will of Ionia. I can even Deadbloom since not a single one of my three Lulus or two Garens have died yet, so I'll always have more reshuffles. It's looking really good until he slams Ruination. I have to use my second and last Will to save Garen, and I replay my other Lulu, but that's one Lulu down. And there's the Costa cast from the Warden's Prey. Oh god, oh Jesus Christ, he's almost killed himself. He's down to one health. Oh my fucking god. If he got two Costa casks, oh, if I lost to that, if I had attacked with a young witch without knowing that he had a Costa cask, what the hell is happening? We threatened the enraged Yeti, but another vengeance kills my first Garen. That's one Garen down too. And we're both basically out of resources at this point. He plays Scuttlegeist, and I top deck a Concerted Strike that keeps me in the game, killing his Scuttle. I get ready to start trading down the board again when a top deck Crumble kills my second Lulu. And this suddenly is a disaster because now my deck only has one Lulu and one Garen left, which means I can't reshuffle more. And my deck has 8 cards left and his deck has 10. And his Vaults of Helia has nothing else to pull out. Like, I can't give Quick Attack because I don't... because Young Witch will just end the game. I have to kill the... I guess I'm just Protectoring, but Protector is terrible. I think I just lose. I actually think so. He just has fucking too many Crumbles and shit. I actually just don't think I can win this. We spend a few turns on pretty inconsequential top decks, his deck staying exactly 2 cards bigger than mine. I'm still not dead, but I'm scrambling to find a way this could even be winnable, because, of course, if I deck out first, then he wins. Is this winnable? I don't see a way to win this. There's nothing Vault can pull. He has Glimpse. If he glimpses into a tie. Here, we have a new hope. So, there's something about how Lab of Legends works that you might not know. If the game goes to a tie, it effectively counts as a redo. You get to start the fight again from your original Nexus health, which at this point is at least better than restarting the entire run from Spiders. Another Thresh on the board though means another Thresh that we cannot afford to let level as my deck goes to 2 cards left. Wanderer tosses. God, that's the toss! The Wanderer tosses! That's why we're behind here. That's why we have a smaller deck than this guy, because the first Wanderer tossed. And his draws are useless, but we draw down to our last Lulu, then our last Garen, and we're out of cards. That's my only chance is to threaten his card in a way that forces him to glimpse it. Just do it. Just glimpse me. Yeah, just do it. Yeah, just fucking glimpse it. No way. Holy shit! Are we good? He draws 2. We're both at 0 cards. And now it's a tie. It should restart. We should get a redo. Experiment inconclusive. And we force a redo. We get to go again. And with that, we're able to rewind, turn back the clocks, and start against Thresh again as if nothing had happened. And I gotta say, this is why I love challenge runs, because especially with hyper difficult ones like this, they force you to exploit the enemy AI as well as it's just some absolutely really, really fringe game mechanics to even be able to have a chance. And so we start our effective 3rd match against Thresh, back to 22 health, and armed with new knowledge, we're not going to lose this time. And in this case, I'm not going to cover every play in the entire early game again, because this second time plays out in mostly the same way, hitting the large beats. Our Chain Vest allows Lulu to level up. Thresh forces out some protection on our units while chipping away at me. For the most part, nothing too different. The big difference here, though, is that Ruination, which is a 1 of in his deck, gets used early, which means my champion reshuffling strategy should be safe this time. A really big decision point, though, happens on turn 8, I have to decide whether to use a Concerted Strike to stop a Glimpse or not. Letting Glimpse go off is how we won the last game, but his early draw could actually overwhelm us and give us less time setting up our reshuffles. I end up using Concerted to stop the Glimpse, but it's really, really close. My first Lulu gets Vengeanced, and we're both low on resources again. I decided safe to play my Deadbloom Wanderer since I have to play for champion reshuffling this time. But this time, without the Yetis shuffling into his deck, and without all his hard removal, hitting my champions, and being able to keep a leveled Lulu on board, we're able to set up a Whimsy Chain, shuffling itself back in as my last card, until finally, we emerge victorious. Alright, we made it past Shadow Isles, we're through Thresh, and all it took was forcing that tie. So I want you guys to keep in mind, at this point, I've been at this for 3 hours already, just to be able to get through Shadow Isles for the first time. For the next power, I picked up the Vanguard Lookout perk to give us a chance against Hexcore's aggression later, if we make it that far, and after a reroll, we took Rush, which I'm actually really happy with here. And we're on to Freljord, starting with Hunters, and against Hunters, there's not really too much to say. Hunters doesn't offer any real answer to this strategy or real aggression, and with our Vanguard Lookout power shutting down their early game, as well as our Frostbite power shutting down their big overwhelm units, there's basically no contest here. I end up using this time to think about and plan out the rest of the run, so that we can think about what we need to be drafting, and my biggest concerns are Hexcore's super aggressive early damage, as well as Sejuani potentially shuffling back herself over and over again with Fury of the North. I start planning out draft options and strategies to be able to beat the entire rest of the run, but Hunters puts up no fight at all, and we move on to the next draft. This is my last reroll, but I do think this is probably the best time to use my last reroll. And I think I'm fine using all my rerolls early into this challenge, to be honest. I end up using my very last reroll and picking Fuzzy Caretaker. For the second option, we have to decide whether we want Garen with Spirit Stone, which can create a fleeting copy of Garen's Judgment in hand, or Deadbloom with Stark's Fervor. I actually think Deadbloom is correct here. The lose condition of this run is just like running out of health, I think. Garen is good against Sejuani, though. I actually end up being so torn on this decision, I decided to leave it up to you guys. So I put a poll up in Twitch chat and let you guys all vote, and Garen won. So we went with it. The Fleeting Garen won't be very useful since I'll need 13 total mana on the same turn to even be able to use his free judgment when I play him, but shuffling more champs is always good. So we start out against Scargrounds, keeping Rush in our opening hand, which is really nice because it's an effective one drop. I mean, something in Runeterra that's really important in deck building is like, if you don't have a one drop, then having like one mana spells to bank the mana on turn one is actually a big deal. I've decided to start attacking in more for Nexus damage as well. It was really scary against 10 HP Shadow Isles opponents because you can't always level Lulu without accidentally killing them, but now we want to start sending opponents into lower health ranges where we can force them to block to our advantage. Also, these Vanguard Lookouts are proving to be completely crazy. They save so much health in the long term. And there's really not too much to say about this game, same as Hunters. It plays out in basically the same way. I mean, they don't really play any threats we can't answer with our typical strategy of protecting our units and using leveled Lulu to trade down the board. In these kinds of challenge runs, some enemies will be incredibly hard and some others will be pushovers. I think it's a good idea to not spend too much time on the pushovers so that we can spend more time focusing on the super crazy fights. And don't you worry, the difficulty of this run is not over yet. Thresh was by far not the hardest opponent I would face. But for now, we have a draft. The first option here is actually a pretty easy Stand United with a health potion. Protecting units and healing our Nexus is just the name of the game here. The second one though is actually really tricky, between Concerted Strike with Wooglitz, Gringly Duo with Doran's Blade, and Will of Ionia with Health Potion. Concerted will be nice to help control Sejuani, but won't help against Hexcore's super aggro, and shuffling too many clones into the deck can be an actual lose condition against Victor, since we won't be able to deal with the catastrophes from Pursuit of Perfection if we're top decking Concerted Strike every single turn. But Duo is also a light elusive blocker, which is crazy against most of PNZ, but in turn could actually cause us to lose versus Sejuani before we even make it there, and Will with Health Potion is amazing too. I'm a lot more worried about losing to PNZ than Sejuani, so I'm really considering Gringlade Duo, but I talk it over with you guys, and you guys talk me into Concerted, which we'll go with, and move on to Sejuani. So we start against Sejuani, and if you thought the entirety of Freljord was going to be easy, then I hate to disappoint you. Sejuani is a lot more rough. Her power that buffs all of her units is pretty efficient and scary, but what I'm most worried about is the tendency to shuffle herself with Fury of the North. Our Frostbite perk helps against one big Overwhelm unit, but if she gets two big Overwhelm units down, we actually have fairly few answers in this deck. Our lookouts are not only helping defensively though, but actually help level Lulu faster to do given supportable bodies, and we're able to secure a really sweet blowout with Rush yet again. Rush coming in hot? Yeah, Rush is huge, guys. I was super happy to reroll the Aegis into Rush. Second Ember Maiden comes down, which is actually really scary. The AI isn't smart enough to attack to trigger Plunder for the Sejuani boats, but if I don't remove the Ember Maiden and they get off the Tusk Rider to double the stats of their entire deck, we won't be able to win anymore, period. We can't deal with that many stats. We force another block though, killing the second Ember Maiden, and we have a wall set up, but we're still really worried about Overwhelm, which we have fairly few answers to here. I continue trading down the board, even sneaking in some lifesteal. A second Avros and Outriders in a row comes down back to back, which makes me really scared about the big Overwhelm units. Like, look at his board. With this many Overwhelm stats, our blockers won't be saving much health, and our hand is really lacking removal. I'm debating how to save the most health, as chat points out, we missed lethal last turn. Lethal last turn? Oh, did I miss lethal? Oh god, I'm... Man, oh, what was I thinking? God, I'm so dumb. Shit. I really had lethal? I decided to block down with Rush at this point, burying the Lulu, but losing the Dead Bloom as we go down to 17 health. Next turn though, we top deck Garen, which gives me a new plan. With the fleeting Garen, he'll give me on play. If I play him next turn at exactly 13 total mana, I'll be able to use his Garen's Judgment as well. This, however, is a super weird turn. I can't actually threaten both Overwhelm units without sending my Lulu to die by getting blocked by Tusk Rider. I'd love to Fey Guide my Lulu to allow me to kill both Overwhelms without losing her, but if I do that, I can't bank the 3 mana full for the Garen Judgment next turn. So we attack to deal damage, but even though it looks like there should be here, there's no possible way to remove both Overwhelm units without tapping under Judgment. Next turn, a buffed Sejuani comes down and uses Fury of the North on top of that for a 12 attack Sejuani. Only one play we have an option even for, which is the Judgment, but we can't kill Sejuani, we go down to 11 health from the Overwhelm. Second Sejuani would be really bad. Yeah, like I have to kill it next turn, and if I don't know if I'll actually have Fury, or I don't know if I'll actually have enough damage to beat through Fury, which is terrifying. Also, Sejuani just leveled up. If that effect ever triggers, our Judgments and Concerted Strikes will be completely useless. Here, I really need to know what she'll do this turn, but it's too risky to pass, so I play a duo just to see whether she uses Fury or not. She taps under with Tusk Rider, which means we can go in to kill Sejuani. This will let her play the new unfrozen Sejuani from hand, but we still need to kill the Sejuanis to be able to win, otherwise they'll just keep shuffling back with Fury of the North. The replacement Sejuani comes down, and here I mess up. I think it's safe to tap under Garen Judgment by playing Barrier, but I forget about another Overwhelm unit that gets drawn, Wolf Rider. And with the Wolf Rider played, I can't play Garen anymore. At this point, I need more Judgments, otherwise I'm screwed. We're taking even more damage here. I block down in a way that sets both her Overwhelm units to 5 health into Garen Judgment range. But in the process, our Nexus also goes down to 5 health. I think about forcing Judgment on my offensive turn, but the bots don't do a good job at open attacking, so I decide to greet it and just keep the Garen for the defensive turn. Through Lulu and Yusari, we challenge both of her units while keeping Garen, and at this point, even though I'm at 5 Nexus HP, we might have made it out of the woods. No more Overwhelm units, and we have Will in hand. One last Sejuani is played, but it actually got too buffed. Since it's the biggest unit on her board, it's not a threat, because my Frostbite perk will actually take care of her every turn. We kill the latest Sejuani, third, fourth, I can't keep track, however many I've killed, and trade down the board with challenges and Concerted Strike for a really close win. 5 health was much lower than I was comfortable going down to here, but we're done with Freljord, and we're fully healing now. Now, we get to the hard part, the 3 scariest opponents, P and Z. This passive pick ended up being hilariously bad. We can't pick Thieves' Tools because Nab is banned. Crush gives us Overwhelm, which is not only useless, but maybe actively detrimental, since we won't be able to force down blocks sometimes without accidentally killing the Nexus. And finally, Clocksetter, which shuffles in a bunch of 2 mana time bombs into our own deck, which isn't great. I mean, keep in mind, we've drafted cards with very specific purposes in mind, and drawing time bombs instead of those cards can be a little too slow, can be a lose condition against stuff like Hexcore's super fast draws, spending more mana. I end up going with Time Bombs because with Vanguard Lookouts, we should have enough protection against Hexcore to make bombs safe. And the other draft is a champion pick, Fury, Challenger, or Twin Shadows for an ephemeral copy on summon. At this point, I basically have to pick Lulu no matter what. Hexcore is too fast for Garen, and Whimsy is how we beat Victor's Catastrophes. I end up settling on Challenger for her to deal with aggression and elusives, but to also protect her from her own support attacks. And with that, we move on to P&Z. So Foundry has really scary aggression, but also draws through its deck so fast that we won't have to survive for very long. Foundry is probably the single most common run ender for me in these challenge runs, but with our Vanguard Lookouts, even with our Challenger tough Lulu and our Dead Bloom Wanderers for healing, we actually aren't given that tough of a time, surprisingly. Keep in mind, this is specifically why I've made a lot of these draft decisions. These challenge runs have taught me to really fear Foundry and draft a lot of early protection for it, and that's pretty much the main reason why our Lulu has both Challenger and Tough, which really carry us through this, even though the other champion items offered were really sweet too. I had to pick Tough and Challenger, and it's finally paying off. Anyway, Akruna comes down on turn 8, our opponent is milling themselves even faster, I guess. I mean, fine by me. At this point, all I care about is trying to maximize our HP with Lifesteal. We end up at the final draw taking one shroom, but other than that, we beat Hexcore with 29 health remaining, which is a personal best for me. That's actually insane. 29 health. Couldn't get the perfect 30. Perfect 30 against Hexcore, dude. All right, so this is easy. This is the run, guys. This is the run. For our reinforcement card, we pick up a pretty easy Stand United. More draws and more health potions attached to it is great, and we move on to the 8th opponent, Guard Bots. Now, Guard Bots should be kind of scary for this kind of challenge, with the 8-8 T-Hex they're generating every turn, but there is something that's in our favor against them, which is that Guard Bots actually have a pretty small deck. It's only like 20 cards. Now, the strategy that I often use against guard bots is to leave their small units alive so their board is too full to summon the bigger turrets, which is normally hilariously effective. This one is a bit different though, because we have the free freezes every turn and the free Lulu barriers, I decide to actually trade down the board. I use a dummy thick time bomb to wipe the board on turn 8, and my strategy pays off. Once the board is wiped and we're freezing and barrier blocking T-Hexes, they aren't really all doing that much. We heal back up to 26, pick up a quick Dead Bloom Wanderer with Spell Shield for the final draft, and with that, there's only one opponent left. But this one, I'm pretty scared about. Between Big Elusives, the 30-30 Overwhelm from Pursuit of Perfection, and his champion spell Deathray shuffling in a total of 4 more cards, he could pretty easily end our run. And Victor's power is also pretty insane, with his units all getting crazy amounts of extra stats based on their keywords. Now, this one starts like any other game. Lulu is Challenger, removing a free threat, but he attacks with Victor on turn 4, which is super early. His deck has literally no answer to a block with an aggressive twin for the trade, so I take down Victor number 1. But without twin disciplines anymore, our Lulu is pretty vulnerable. And on my next attack, I actually casually forget my Lulu has Challenger. Drag with Lulu? Yeah, why didn't I just drag with Lulu? He doesn't actually block Caretaker here, right?
Yes, I do.
God, imagine if after all this, we just literally threw, huh? Wouldn't that be crazy? Wouldn't that be wacky? So yeah, that was awkward. But I killed the Mimic anyway with Russian Time Bomb. Letting Victor get Elusives down is just too scary. And at least I get to kill the second Victor that comes out on turn 6 as well. A Subpersible accompanies the second Mimic, so we're taking some Elusive damage already, since we have no Elusive blockers right now, somehow. We end up stabilizing the board and setting up against his draws. At this point, I have to be really careful to not use too many Concerted Strikes. Wooglitz is super dangerous for this challenge. If we shuffle in too many Concerted Strikes that might be forced to use to alleviate pressure, they'll shuffle more in, and that can snowball out of proportion, because if it's all I'm top decking every round, I'll be forced to use them every round, and if I get blocked out of drawing answers to the 30-30 Overwhelm Catastrophe from Pursuit of Perfection, we could lose the entire run. Victor then plays Deathray, shuffling back more copies, extending the game. And this is where I realize the problem. What round is this? Round 15? Wait, we're in round 15 and he has 25 cards left in his deck. They added the 40 round limit? Wait! What's gonna happen? That's exactly 40. We're going to round 16. He has 24 cards left in his deck. Are we... You see, there's something else I haven't told you about how labs work in Runeterra. To prevent scenarios of players getting completely stuck, there's a hidden rule in labs that if the game goes to round 40, it will immediately end in a tie, which will force a reset of the match. Again, just like it did versus Thresh before. And because of that death ray, shuffling back in, at this rate, his deck will go to zero on exactly turn 40. If we can't get him to draw more cards than he shuffles back in at this point, it ends in a tie, which will cause a loop, because there's no more drafts at this point, and if that happens, I'm gonna be stuck in an infinite loop fighting Victor over and over again with the same deck until we can figure out a way through with only the cards we currently have get him to deck out faster than he reshuffles. Luckily though, Pursuit of Perfection at least won't be an issue as this happens. It's a progress day. He just discarded it! What? He just discarded it! Mister, what are you doing? We're able to stabilize just building up a board. I mean, the board doesn't even matter at this point. There's no way we can run out of life anymore. We just need to be able to figure out some way to end the game before turn 40 without killing his Nexus. We need him to draw cards. But then he plays another death ray, and we can't stop this. Death ray's reshuffle is unconditional. We can't fizzle it. We need deny or nopify or something to stop it, but we don't have any in our deck, and we have no more drafts. I mean, if it's a tie, we'll restart, but if I can't... If there's no way in this draft to be able to handle this, then I'm stuck in an infinite loop. He's literally holding me in an infinite loop. I'm hostage. And the game goes on like this for many turns, me frantically trying to figure out how to stop the infinite loop using only the resources that I currently have until it happens. He iterated Dead Bloom! Wait! He iterated Dead Bloom! And now it doesn't go, it goes through Spell Shield. So he's tossing. Are we good? And immediately, as soon as the Dead Bloom is played, it tosses the final death ray out of his deck. Listen, I'd love to pretend that this was on purpose, but by removing all of his large units and by not playing any of our followers bigger than Dead Bloom, in doing so, we forced the AI to copy the Dead Bloom. And just like that, by doing the exact right things that led to the AI running himself out of cards purely by accident. And that was it. And there it is. We're good. Lab of Legends, of course. Without killing the Nexus once. Mill condition every single time. This was a crazy run. This was so crazy. The Thresh at the start. I was so worried we were going to be trapped in an infinite loop there at the end. So there you have it. Lab of Legends without killing a single Nexus. That was a really difficult one. It is absolutely insane that we were able to take down that entire challenge on just our second attempt run. I actually expected this one to take at least a dozen attempts, but we got pretty lucky with how that run played out in so many ways. This is a challenge that you guys have been requesting for a couple of months now, and I've been dreading it a little bit because I knew just how difficult it would end up being, but we've finally done it. And I mean, it's kind of cliche, but this isn't just my win, it's your guys' win too. I'm not bullshitting when I say I literally couldn't have done it without you guys. I talked through pretty much everything with Twitch chat, and you guys voting for some of the specific drafts, like I would not have chosen the Garen item, the Fleeting Judgment one, or the Wooglets with Concerted Strike without you guys voting on them at the time. Or even just being in chat and sometimes stopping me from doing something dumb from brain fart, you know? I have so much fun doing these lab challenge runs alongside you guys, genuinely. And a lot of you have said you really like these runs on YouTube too. So we're gonna be doing more of them. I guess this is the point where I do the YouTuber thing and ask you guys if there's other kinds of challenges you want to see done in Lab of Legends in the comments. Please let me know. I'm always looking to do more of these. And if you liked the video, come stop by my Twitch channel sometime. I stream Legends of Runeterra daily, and when I get around to it, the next lab challenge I'm currently working on beating is beating labs by only using landmarks and spells. No playing units from hand. It's terrible. It's the most ridiculous and cruel lab challenge I've done to date, But if that sounds fun to watch, pop into my chat sometime and say, Swim, when are you gonna keep trying to do your no units lab challenge? And I hope to see you guys there. And until then, I'll see you guys next time.